Oh, that's not good. Just gonna between your legs. Actors should know, because like the editors hate it when there's like this on the end of it.
Hey, Rex. How are you doing? Oh, I should probably put
my hey, you guys, somebody's getting interviewed over here, right? Jeez. Yeah.
You're having a not a bad fall.
A bad
winter.
I know, it's good. It's been great. It's exciting.
Did you, I mean, was this the plan? Was to open in March and to hold all the way through the rest of the year? Or?
You know, I wish we could say it was the plan, but obviously, you know, I think when we finished the movie, first of all, we just, you know, when you finish it, you suddenly want to just get it out to the world. I mean, you don't really want to just kind of sit there thinking there's this thing that you're so proud of and you work so hard on, and you just have to sit on it for a while. And I think also, we wanted to put it out at a time where it would do really well, you know, theatrically, which is, you know, important to these movies to be able to get the next ones made. And we'd had good luck with Moonrise Kingdom, putting that out at a sort of time where there was a post-festival run. We went to Cannes and ran out that way. This time we sort of did a similar thing, but doing Berlin as the launching post. And that made sense because, you know, the movie's quite winter, visually wintery.
Right.
It's also was shot in Germany, so we had, you know, we had the support of the people in Berlin, and we opened the festival there. And so it was a surprise that it, you know, it did that well, and we were happy about that. And then when the awards season came around, we were sort of, you know, we sort of started to feel this momentum. We're like, is this really going to happen? And, you know, hopefully, you know, everybody says there's the conventional wisdom, and I always say if it's conventional wisdom is kind of got to be wrong most of the time, or everybody will be right all the time.
That's true. Sense. So, I mean, take me to the beginning of when you start down this road. I mean, what is the first conversation that you have with Wes?
About the movie.
As you're approaching the movie, yeah.
I mean, I knew he was working on this story, I think even before Moonrise Kingdom. He was working on a story that was based on a character that was based on a friend that he and Hugo Guinness had, you know, just as a launching off point for a character, as you know, the personality, and he was working on this idea, and I knew he was reading a lot of Stefan Zweig stuff, and then Moonrise Kingdom happened, and I remember he had all these Zweig books often in the edit room, and he was, you know, they were sort of going off on these, you know, he and Hugo would go off and kind of lock themselves up and work, but you know, really at a certain point I knew it was happening. He sent the finished script, you know, and he said, "What do you think of this?" And read it, and I was like, "Okay, this is incredible. It's so rich and, you know, visual and story and action," and it was like it sort of hit all the buttons of being like funny but also being, you know, dramatic and having just this plot that was like so rich. So it was exciting to read and also kind of nerve-wracking to read because I was like, okay, you know, now what? And he's like, so what's the next step? So that's sort of how it started. And then you know,
so is he saying to you, what's the next step? Or are you, I mean, is there the presumption that after Moonrise you guys are married? Or
no, I mean, we've been I've worked on four or five, I mean, I'd worked on Life Aquatic as in visual effects, and then on Darjeeling and Mr. Fox and Moonrise and this. So, you know, I think there was an assumption, yeah, I wanted to be part of it. It was an assumption I was gonna be part of it. But I think really the next step was, you know, Wes, as soon as he's ready to make something and he's got it and he knows he just wants to start going instantly. Mm-hmm. So really it was, the next step was like, okay, where can we make this thing? How are we gonna make this thing? So we started, you know, he was over, I think at that point in Paris, I was in New York. We had some of our other collaborators, you know, who, our executive producer and associate producer, just everybody kind of starting to look for hotels and schlosses and castles. And we just started looking on the internet, and Wes had found all these amazing photochromes in the Library of Congress, which, you know, maybe Adam will touch upon. And we started looking through that library and both looking at images for reference, but also looking for like this idea that there might be this real hotel that we could just find somewhere that just might have just been shuttered and sitting there forgotten on the top of an Alp somewhere or something. So we did look for all those both on the internet, and we researched, we found this guy in Austria who wrote all these books on grand hotels, and we ordered all those on the internet, and we tried to get his advice, and we, you know, we just sort of used every contact we would. We sort of gathered a bunch of potential places that looked interesting, some of which were now museums and castles, and some which were dormant buildings, and then a lot of them sort of seemed to be centered either in Germany, or we also wanted to go to Prague and Hungary, Czech Republic and Hungary. And then we sort of said, okay, now we got enough information together. We reached out to some location scouts and had them even find a few other places and make some contacts. And then we did our first part of the process, which is always, to me, one of the most fun, just like a bunch of guys in a van driving around, you know, Wes and myself and Adam. We did a couple of trips, you know, and sometimes it would be a week or too, and just driving to all these places. Like, we take these routes, and Wes is an amazing navigator. I mean, he will look through these maps and he'll thought out everything, and he'll be like, you know, it probably makes sense to go to Kessel Felsenstein before Schloss. I can't remember the names of these places. And
it's so Wes Anderson to think that he's sitting there with maps in 2015.
Well, I mean, he's using iPhone too. I mean, he's high tech. You know, he's very good with the Google scouting. And when we do travel around, it's like, it really is kind of like a buddy film school vibe, where you're driving around and we stop in this town and we eat their special pretzel and have one of their beer, their chocolate beer, whatever they have. And then we go there and we're on our way to the next castle, and, you know, we see something up on a hill. And we're like, what's that? And we go up. So it's really like this free time, because what happens is we find places, and we, you know, a lot of the places we find are never going to be good for, you know, we only needed one place to be the hotel.
Right.
But in every place we found little things. We'd see a little portrait on a wall somewhere and take a picture of that. And, that would end up, you know, being the model for the outfit that, you know, one of the sister, you know, the Madame D's, the three sisters wore. Or mm-hmm. we would find a little coat of arms, and that would become a basis for something else. So everywhere we kind of just started to collect inspiration and data and bits that kind of informed and enriched the story that was already really, really rich on the page.
So was there a moment where you found the hotel? Was that the...
Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of moments where we didn't find the hotel, which was what happened first. I mean, we went to, you know, at first we thought, it was originally scripted and thought of that the hotel would be decaying. So in the 60s period, you'd go to this grand hotel and it would be a faded glory. And so we were looking, we said, well, you know, we're happy to look at buildings that are kind of crumbling a little bit. So we had the tour of the future haunted houses of Europe. I mean, these amazing, you know, everything from like hospitals to institutions, anything that might have big grand spaces, because of course even if they were like a hospital, they may have had something that looked like a grand ballroom that we could use as a lobby or as a right. ballroom. And we went to a lot of hotels, and we also toured the backs of hotels, like, you know, ones in the Atlantic in Hamburg or Claridge's. We just sort of went to all these hotels and saw how the front and back of the house looked and worked. And a lot of that, you know, for Adam, obviously, it was incredibly important. For Wes, it's also it was important just because he would, you know, you start to learn. It's like that research that you learn how to make this thing actually live in a world that, you know, you've invented out of your mind, and, you know, how the people actually, where the food and the laundry go and all those things, which then inform what we built, but also what we shot. So we looked at a lot of these decrepit places, and at a certain point, like, we were, you know, we were like, from a producerial point of view, we were sort of thinking this would be probably a big health, safety, you know, God knows what, it's probably whatever, there's probably like asbestos, killer mold, and the ceiling about to collapse on our heads in here. And then in the end, we sort of, you know, and we talked, could we build the lobby? I mean, we haven't found any place, could we build the big lobby? And, you know, we needed the film to have scope and scale, because we saw this as a very grand movie and it couldn't feel small. And despite the fact that it's an independent budget, we just want it to be scopey. And so we found this, the place we eventually found was an old department store that was built in 1906, I think, in this German town called Görlitz, which is this beautiful sort of UNESCO heritage town. But this department store was shuttered. The way we found it, it was our last day of our scout. We were heading back to Berlin, and Klaus Derelman, our location manager, had said, you know, there was that other place you'd marked off on the photos that you thought was interesting. Should we go see it? And they'll let us in until 6, and it was 5:30, and we're like, how far away is it? He's like, 25 minutes. And that was like German 25 minutes with like a Autobahn experienced driver. So we gunned it all the way there. We got in the last 5 minutes, and right away these guys were scurrying around. We looked at the space and we're like, okay, it has the scale. It has like incredible height. It had the most magnificent stained glass ceiling. It had these marble columns, and then a lot of the rest of it just looked like Woolworths. You know, it was just like those like racks of pegboard and stuff that were just there from, and you know, but it had the staircase and it had the bones. And I think from then, you could tell the energy changed, and it's like, this was gonna be our place. And everybody went home, and Wes was really happy. And then I had to, talk to the location manager about getting it. And he says, well, you know, the problem is this place is owned by a company that's gone bankrupt. And we started digging into it. It turned out to be like this Dutch company, holding company that had gone bankrupt, that owned this German holding company. It was like a $500 million bankruptcy that was affected, you know, hundreds of properties all around Europe. Mm-hmm. And I got to the liquidator, the, I forget the name of the word, not executive, but the receiver. And I spoke to the receiver, and he was like, we can't do anything in there because my whole plan is I need to make sure there's no activity in these buildings. Otherwise, if I'm earning any income, it will mess up the whole, all the lawsuits that are against us. And I was like, so it became this, like, you know, project, which was like, became, fell into me and the other producers to just try and push through getting this building, because it was like the only place in Europe after driving around for months, you know, that we found. And eventually we did.
With 5 minutes to go.
And when we did get it, everything else fell into place near there. So basically all these other great locations we'd found, whether it's like bathhouses in Hungary or, you know, fields in Munich or whatever, we sort of said, okay, well, we can't shoot in any of these other places. We have to bring everything right close together and almost like say, this is our Zubrovka, you know, this is our town, our fictional town, and let's find everything within this radius. And if we can't find it, we'll build it, or we'll do a lot of, you know, hybrid building where we'd find a space that was interesting, and then Adam and Wes would sort of concoct something that would be built onto there. Excuse me.
So you figured it out.
We figured it out. We did it. We shot it. It was actually, and actually we had this little miracle moment, which was exciting to me, but probably not exciting to very many other people. But, you know, we were in this town, and it's all these buildings from centuries, you know, different centuries, and a lot of little Warren-y buildings and stone and, you know, no internet and everything. But this department store building, when we got it, we were like, okay, we can build the lobby here, we can build Madame D's suite, all the hotel stuff here. But we were looking for offices, and we were trying to find a place to have offices, and this is not a town that has office buildings. And at one point, our location manager calls after, like, when he's checking on up in the ceiling, in the roof for, like, heating power conditions that we need to fix before we shot in there. And we found, he's like, you know what? There's an entire ring of offices on the top floor here. So in the end, our production offices were on the top of that hotel set, and there was a full ring of offices all around the skylight that you see. And that was where we based the production.
And it sounds like ultimately it was like almost like a college campus.
Yes, it was
for you guys.
It was like a college campus slash studio backlot, because we had golf carts to drive around in the snow, which work incredibly well, and they're really fun. Donuts in a golf cart. And we also had everybody living in, you know, well, first of all of the department heads and a lot of the foreign crew and all the actors, we took over this one little hotel that was in the main square. And it was just a really family-run, friendly little place. You know, not a lot of services. I mean, they had breakfast, and it's the kind of hotel that at night has a little sign outside saying, you know, if you need to get in, call this number. You know, so it was that kind of place. And
you got Bill Murray when they called us.
Yeah, we got Bill. Bill Murray.
Bill Murray would answer the phone and come get the door for you.
So we all lived in there, and we ate together, and we just hung out. And then there was like the cafe pub across the street, which was the sort of hangout place at one corner of the square. And the other corner of the square was the restaurant where everybody liked to eat. And the fourth corner of the square was the town hall, where we were able to convince them to let us use the basement of the town hall as our edit room. So basically we had like everyone living here, pub here, restaurant here, edit room there, and, you know, golf carts out here, and we were ready to go. So it was kind of like, and we could walk everywhere. And, you know, one thing that, you know, Wes likes to be very, very prepared and is an amazing preparation. And you know, we've learned over the years to hone our system of how our team works together. And, you know, we have a lot of frequent re-collaborators. And I think one of the things that we've learned is, you know, you never want to waste any time shooting. You've got limited shooting days, and those are the most expensive. So the thing that we really try and do is just keep this open communication and process very transparent, so that, you know, like Bob and Adam and Wes can go, and the ADs can go over to the place we're shooting a day from now, or 2 days from now, or 3 days from now, at the end of the day, or in the morning before we shoot, or on the weekend. And they're all, so we realize if everything's within, you know, walking or golf carting or a quick 10-minute drive distance, you really can keep cycling through everything you're building and looking at, so that nothing, you don't get there on the day and say, this is not gonna work. You can go over there with the camera and check out and say, you know what, Adam, we're gonna have to push this wall back 2 feet, Bob won't be able to use lights, and they do it, so it's not happening on the day and like burning a shooting day. And that adds a level of efficiency, and it also allows us to not make any more set or any more than we actually need to shoot. And that, I think, has huge dividends. It's way more fun than, you know, getting up at 6 a.m. and like driving an hour to a location to just sort of walk to the location, and it's way more efficient. So it was great. It was really fun to be in that town, and we had a ball with Bill, and, you know, bowling days with Jude Law bowling with Bill Murray. I mean,
well, it sounds like people, like the actors, I'm talking to the actors back in Germany all those months ago, It sounds like people kind of almost hung out longer than they had to in order to just be with a group. You know, there was a,
totally.
A camaraderie in the group.
You yeah. Want
to deliver?
Yeah, we had a nice, whoops, I've dropped my microphone here. This is real-time television, folks.
There you go.
Uh-oh.
He's a producer, not a sound engineer.
Yeah. How's that? Still sounding okay? You'd think, logistics with that many actors and schedules, you'd think it'd be very, very complicated, but we had a bunch of the guys, Willem and Goldblum and Jeff Goldblum and Edward, they came and, they were all staying in this hotel together and, maybe they brought their partner or their wife or their partner right. and their laptop. And if it was, and they might have a day, they might've been around for 4 or 5 weeks with a bunch of days off and
right.
not days off, just sort of go for a wander in the town and work on their next project and take a side trip to Prague for the day or whatever. But they would just hang out and they'd always want to be back for dinner because we'd all eat together. And it was like kind of a recap of the day and we're all flushed from being out in the freezing snow all day long. It was really, 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 it's enjoyable. And I think that's something that, Wes is really likes to foster and I think helps actually sort of infuse itself into the films, which is like, if everyone's embedded there together, mm-hmm. you get in the spirit of it. You're not going home and like switching to a different mode and then coming back and it's work, play.
Right.
It's all one experience and it's important both creatively and it's also important because it is our lives. Like we are going off as vagabond hobos and making a movie somewhere. You want to not just say at the end, the result is, I love this movie. You want to say, I loved making the movie, too.
Well, so oftentimes the story, when people say they love making a movie, sometimes the movie's not so good. So that both is kind of a glorious rarity when
right.
people are this kind of connected and yet also make a great movie.
Totally. And, one thing that I think is amazing is, everybody was so at... obviously, we've got some of the most talented craftspeople and crew people and, as well as actors in the world. Everybody was so on their game. Just everything just kind of popped even more than it always pops. And walked in that lobby and even the 60s lobby we walked in, I was just like, wow, I never want to take pictures of the sets that I'm on. I'm like, wow, I got to take, this is too amazing. The hair and makeup and Mark and Francis and those guys did, Rafe wore a wig the entire movie every single day. Mm-hmm. And he was on screen almost the whole movie. And we didn't do one digital fix to a wig or hair of his for the entire film. Same thing with Tilda's whole kind of crazy old age prosthetics. That stuff was like flawless. Like we'd look at it as close as we could, blow it up screen. There was nothing we would have improved
now,
digitally.
I got to tell you, Mark said almost exactly the opposite in that regard. He was talking
really?
About the fact that with Tilda's makeup, that the fact that actually now because of digital cleanup you can do, that the 10th hour, the 14th hour, whatever, because he said that because Wes doesn't really like them
yeah.
to be on set touching up all the time, that if there was a little thing here or a little whatever, that it could be fixed. That
we
it
should
wasn't
get Mark over here. Mark.
Mark, I think, left.
We did not, he wasn't there in post. He left,
right.
He probably assumed we did, but I was overseeing all the post. We didn't do any digital fixes on her makeup or hair at all.
Wow.
Not at all.
Because he was he was
probably worried
about it,
but we didn't. And, and he may have felt like it was sagging, but actually it looked amazing. We didn't do
yeah.
any. And same with Rafe, but, and I think also with the production design, it just felt like everybody was really, really on their game. Not that they aren't always, but
right.
it's just one of those things where everything gelled really
nicely.
Adam
was saying that he and the set decorators and everybody would just like kind of move on to the next, when you were shooting, that they would just be moving on to the next day.
Yeah.
They didn't worry about hanging around too much and, because Wes apparently just is kind of go.
Yeah. Well, once the thing is set, they had enough to do to be on to the next place.
Yeah.
And the hotel itself was like a fully 360, not even, 360 every dimension.
Right.
It was a fully immersed set. Like you couldn't see the lights most of the time, except for,
mm-hmm.
We bring some local lights in for the closest, but
yeah.
the general scene was like lit. We were pounding all this light through the skylight. So that was like the basic light. And then we had all these lights that were practicals in the hotel, like these
mm-hmm.
kind of little, kind of those in the arches, there were lights
right.
and lamps and big chandelier and all that kind of, and we'd put a little smoke in there in the 30s period, but it was really felt like, it was like a warm, cozy, giant space. There wasn't this sort of barrier between the set and the not set when you were in the main hotel lobby. And that was the first stuff we shot. You know, the 60s and the other hotel was the first thing we shot. And that actually, I think, really got everybody in the mood, because you'd walk in that, you wanted to hang out in that hotel set. It was just like big and amazing. And the carpets, like, and we, they made every one of those carpets. I didn't know you could design rugs and just get them made. You know, I'm thinking I'm going to come up with something crazy for my living room and get Adam to do
that. A big picture of Wes. Perfect. So, I mean, I think it's interesting because Wes decided not to do video this year. So, I mean, I've shot him for the last three or four movies, and I kind of feel like he's, in a weird way, kind of come of age with this movie. And he seems calmer. Talking to him off camera, you know, in Germany and whatever, he seems much kind of like completely at peace with things in a way. He seemed a little bit more uncomfortable in years past, I guess, with talking. But it sounds like the experience of working with Wes is very different than people would presume. I think there's this sense of him being this kind of mad genius who's so, you know, it's so about his vision. But it sounds like it's incredibly collaborative, incredibly...
I think here's the thing. He's incredibly specific and incredibly precise with ideas about every aspect of it, whether it's sound or music or, I mean, and he just... But he also loves all that stuff. So if he finds someone that he likes, I mean, he directs all aspects of this stuff, but he really gets, you know, but he obviously has to trust. I mean, he's not going to make these sets. He's not going to, you know.
Right.
And you know, there's a lot of... if you work out a methodology with him, like with the visual stuff, with research and references and things, and then Adam presents sketches and drawings and concept art, and then, you know, there's a lot of back and forth and direction that's shaping. But I think... I think the thing about Wes is he is a creative genius. He also loves making movies. I mean, it's what he loves to do, and what he wants to do in these things is get them perfect. And and I think that it's easy to appreciate that if someone really just wants, okay, let's do this at the highest level and make this amazing, and I'm going to push you to do that. And so I think that's, you know, why the people keep coming back, because they get to make, and also if you're a designer or a photographer or makeup, like, you read a script, you're like, I get to do all this. Like, this is cool. I'm not making, you know, a contemporary restaurant. I'm doing something completely fantastical and wild and grounded in reality, and it's going to be an adventure.
But the road trip with the boys sounds very kind of...
That's fun. Those are fun. Because first of all, we all like to eat well, so we always find, like, I mean, there's definitely a moment always like, okay, we're on our way from Baden to this. Probably around 6, we'll be around. Let's find the best restaurant in, you know, Bad Schandau. And then we start looking, and then maybe we'll Google, and then we ask a guy, and we end up going someplace, and we try the local specialty. And it doesn't have to be a fancy restaurant. It'll be like, we want to kind of experience those places. And especially the kind of old places that haven't changed, that are like, you know, have been like that in Europe forever, you know.
On the other side of the Iron Curtain, or?
Yeah, and we take a lot of trains from time to time, and we also, like, went to some really weird places. I mean, like, the town of Nebelsbad, which is the fictional town where it takes place, the Bad means sort of bath, so it's like, it's supposed to be a spa town, like Carlo Vivari or Marienbad, or which Carlo Vivari was called Carlsbad, you may know. And so it was supposed to be one of these spa bath towns. So we went to, like, all the old spa bath towns. And, you know, some of them, like Carlo Vivari, has been sort of fixed up, and there's the festival there. Then there's, like, Marienbad, which has been forgotten a little bit more. It's now called Marianski Lazni. Mm. Lazni is, like, baths, I guess, too. And in Czech. See, I'm learning.
They got their Czech back.
and that place, you know, that was the place, actually, where we got the inspiration, one of the inspirations for what the 60s hotel was like, because we showed up in Marienbad, and the most famous old hotel in Marienbad is just completely shuttered up in the main square. And there's pictures of, like, King Edward, you know, outside that thing in 19 whatever. And we tried to look inside, and it looked like it's literally crumbling. And then we saw another beautiful old hotel on the main street there, but it was quite small. And we went in the lobby thinking, well, maybe this will have a cool lobby. Mm-hmm. And the lobby there was, like, drop ceiling, wood paneled stairs, 60s, and maybe that's even where the honeycomb kind of ceiling came from. Anyway, I remember that was a moment where Wes and Adam were just like, okay, this is interesting, because this idea that came out of scouting was that instead of the hotel being something that was kind of decrepit, it should be something that was that had been kind of the soul destroyed through the layers of history and communism, you know, that kind of drop ceiling panels, strip away the cornices because it's, like, too expensive to keep them up, which is almost like a sadder way to, like, destroy something beautiful, as you know, when you go and see something, a terrible reno.
So as a group, do you, you come into a picture like this, is there a sense of, I mean, this is now his number one picture domestically and internationally.
Yep.
Is that an issue as producers? I mean, obviously you want to make enough money that you make the next movie and it's not a problem, but are you thinking, wow, this could be the biggest one, or is it, is everyone just its own adventure and the money is, you know, you got to make enough money to, I think you flipped the...
Yeah, I know, I'm trying to figure out how to do this. I think I got it like that. See?
You made it for girl.
There you go.
You got it back for boy.
No, I think that it's, each one is its own animal, and I think when I'm doing these things, if, you know, if Wes brings me in to work with it, I'm always like, my mind, like, our boss right now is this movie. You know, that's how I think about it. It's like, how can we make the, how can we do it, serve everything for this movie? And then it comes out. And, you know, there's obviously people thinking about, the, you know, you're always thinking about the release and how it's going to do. But that's really the focus when you're making the movie, is just 100% on, like, making a great movie. And then you sort of hope the rest will come. And I think, you know, I don't think the next one is in your mind when you're making this one. You know, obviously, when one does well, it probably sets different expectations and people think about things differently. And you know, I think that it's, I would assume that it's easier if you're, you know, people to say, for him to make the next one, but we've already, you know, very lucky to have been, you know, that hasn't been the problem. There's a lot of people who want to, and you know, in any paintbrush, it was just support his creativity and trust it, that this is someone with an interesting and original and, you know, voice that is important to keep making these movies. And, you know, people are starting to, more and more people are starting to kind of see them over the last few, and that's great, because I think this year, if you look at the whole field of the Academy nominees, there's a lot of movies up there that are really just like individual voices of an auteur. And, you know, some years it's more like that and some less, but it is kind of inspiring that I think to other filmmakers and to young filmmakers and hopefully to executives that you can, if somebody's making a movie that's true to their vision and you support those, some of these movies are going to be like the ones you remember the most.
Yeah.
And I think that's why I like working with Wes or people with someone like him, is that it's, I feel like I'm working on something that is, you know, it's a thing that is, it's like, it's an important piece of creativity to help support. And that's why I do it.
Well, it's interesting because Wes is kind of like Woody Allen in a way, though, in some ways the opposite of, I mean, he's the other side of the coin in that his films are extremely visual. It's a very different kind of filmmaking, but there is this sense that, like, Woody doesn't even sell his domestic rights until after he's made the film now, because there's so many people over the rest of the world who want to pay for his movies that he gets it funded, and then when he's done, he then, you know, makes a deal with Sony Classics or whoever, and, you know, Wes has a slightly higher budget range, I guess, to make his movies, but, you know, it seems like he has that kind of thing where there are people out there who want to see these movies made and will support the effort. Even when it's not the biggest hit of the year, but it's, you know, the second biggest or whatever of his career.
Yeah, no, I think that's true. I mean, that's just because I think there are people everywhere who sort of, I think, support the idea that people are making their own vision. I think they're also very entertaining movies and interesting. I mean, like, Wes is an incredible writer. He could write any, you know, I mean, even when he does those Cormac McCarthy spoofs in Tenenbaum, like, he can really, I feel like he could sort of say, write a Hitchcock thing, write this, and he could do it. He could imitate the voice probably if he wanted to. I mean, if you have in every element in these movies, when there's like a newspaper article someone's reading or poetry that's being recited by Mr. Gustav, like all those things are written by Wes in just different voices, and he can turn it on. He sent me an email the night with like a newspaper article, and I'm like crying, laughing at the thing that he's able to conjure up. Like, my favorite is actually Mr. Fox's column that he wrote in Fantastic Mr. Fox, which is like just this gibberish of like a mind of a crazy fox writing in this sort of lofty, pretentious way, and it's just like he's so on point. So I think he's a great writer. He's got a great voice, and I think he was able to do in this movie, which is not an easy balance, is take something that is like, he basically tried to encompass like the history of 20th century Europe in an hour and a half, and not worry so much about, like, you know, everybody knows the actual historical events, whether it's, you know, the fascism and Nazism and the effect of the wars and the Iron Curtain. But I think that what he was able to do was kind of express the kind of feeling of loss of, like, what could have been and the promise that could have been in Europe. And you know, when you look at Europe in the earlier part of the century, there was all this, you know, air travel, and these are things that Stefan Zweig wrote about. Air travel had just started to come of age, and people were feeling all this promise, and there was the, you know, there was money, and you had Paris in the 20s, you had all this kind of richness, and you had all these amazing artists, and then you had also all this sort of tragedy and death and flu epidemics, and then, you know, communism, and all that stuff kind of changed the course of history, and we don't know what could have been. And I think in some ways, you know, the character Mr. Gustav is supposed to represent that, and the sort of feeling that Zero has, just being left with this, you know, having lost everything, you know, somebody to disease and somebody else to war and fascism, and in fact even lost the glory of the hotel that's now a sad space. And I think that that's something that I think he wanted to express and did a very good job of, and all within, wrapped up in this kind of comedic, this comedic world, which makes it fun and palatable to watch. So I'm hoping that people see the movie and also kind of get something out of that about, like, you know, they feel this Hollywood version of Europe-ness in it.
Well, it's a little, I mean, because it is Hollywood. I mean, there's a love of film that is also very apparent. There's, you know, and there's certainly tragedy in the movie and great big, screwball comedy going on at the same time. And I mean, I think that's what, one of the things that's fascinating about Wes is that he's able to kind of somehow shove all those things together, these very disparate ideas or genres, and kind of make it completely sane as an idea. You know, it's like you completely go with it, even though you couldn't possibly all fit together, and yet somehow he does it.
Yeah, it's a fully immersive world, and I think that's partly why the design and the music, everything has to be like so specific and so unique, is that you have to go in that world, never question that you're in some sort of fantastical, not our world of time and space, and then you can live in the story. And I think that's something that, you know, I know he was inspired on this by some of the older Hollywood movies and by Lubitsch, and I think in his mind he wanted, that's why he didn't worry that everybody was speaking in different accents and things. He was like, listen, this is like this in some sense is like the old Hollywood version of what Central Eastern Europe would be like, shop around the corner or something. You know, it's like, it's a sort
Edward G. Robinson as the Pharaoh.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, and he's like, well, that was okay then, and it's just as transporting. And I think the point is, as long as you're transported, you know, we're not trying to make it real, but we are trying to say real things and also be entertaining and just make something that just is such a perfect whole.
So is all of this, since you finished the movie, I mean, is the success of the box office, now Oscar nominations, everything else, is that all just a cherry on top of it for you? Are you kind of happy and pleased with everything that happened by the time you're done, you know, when the film's finally locked and you're like, I'm satisfied?
I mean, I think you just take it step by step. Like when we finished it, we were almost finished it, and the guys from Berlin came and watched the film, and they, you know, nobody, we hadn't really showed the film to anybody, you know, we tested, and they came, we set them up in London, they were, you know, Dieter and his programmer, and they watched it, and afterwards came out and said, it's great. We want, you know, we want to open the festival. So that felt like a victory. Like each thing's just like a little victory. And you know what? I guess it obviously is great when people like the movies you make. You want them to be, especially if you like them and you think that, you know, you're proud of them. And that's, and then you want people to see them. You don't want to end up on the shelf. And all those things are just little different bits of gravy. And you know, but Wes is definitely focused always on, you know, like, let me start thinking about what I want to do next. Because ultimately, it's like, if you're a movie maker, you make movies for a living. You don't, you know, you have to promote them and you have to help, but you really, you know, your living isn't promoting them. It's creating these things and giving them to the world. And I'm proud to have been part of this one.
So will you be nervous in February?
Microphone obviously didn't want to ask that one.
Mic drop, yeah.
You know, with the Globes, at the Globes when we won, I sort of just assumed we weren't going to win. So it just kind of popped up and they said the name of our movie. So I'm hoping it'll be kind of the same, but you know, I don't be nervous. I think I'd be more nervous to have to actually get up there than to hear what they're gonna say.
Anyway, you're voting against yourself.
Would not vote against myself. I'm sure if we win, you know, Wes will be doing the talking. He's much more eloquent.
There you go. I assume he'll have written something.
I hope so.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dave.
Appreciate it.
Bye.
Woohoo!